Good afternoon. So last time we were able to write down field equations of electrodynamics into two parts. One part was metric independent. Yeah? So this, we have noticed that the entire information about those four fields, namely electric field, magnetic induction, magnetic field and electric induction, can be encoded within two different differential forms. So, and equations, Maxwell equations could be written in that form, where J, so is J is four-dimensional current, which encoded both electric charge and electric current. And to write down those equations, which correspond to four Maxwell equations, I say four, which is already a relatively modern version, because if you read Maxwell paper, there are eight equations, and each of them takes half a page, roughly speaking. It was Heaviside who invented those short writings, divergence, curl, and so on and so on. But now we have found even shorter notation. So two equations, namely Gauss law for magnetic field plus magnetic induction law is contained here, whereas Gauss law for, this is magnetic, this is electric. Gauss law for electric field, namely divergence of D equal to rho, is contained here, plus the Ampere law, which originally was telling us that when we have a current, it is accompanied by a circular magnetic field, but this was an old version, and Maxwell himself added this term D dot, which he called the current of So this new version of Ampere law is contained here, and that's all. And for that purpose we absolutely do not need any metric. However, these equations do not, it is not the whole story. In order to have the whole story, we must add relation between these and those. On a very naive level, we were writing E equal D and B equal H. However, if we really want to keep formulae in such a way that they are valid in any curvilinear system of coordinates, we cannot write down this simply, because D and B are vector densities, whereas E and H are covectors. Therefore, a priori, they cannot be identified. But if we, in order to be able to identify them, we must have a metric. And this is what the metric is good for in electrodynamics. Namely, if we have, for instance, D, which is a vector density, so it has an upper index, but it is not a vector, because when we pass to different coordinates, we have still to remember that it is a density, therefore we must multiply or divide by determinant of the Jacobi matrix. Therefore, first of all, we must produce a vector. For that purpose, we divide it by the square root of determinant of the metric. Now, this quantity is already a vector. But still it is not sufficient, because we cannot write down that it is equal to EK. Why? Because this is a covector and this is a vector. Vectors and covectors can be naively identified when we use orthonormal basis, because then metric is a unit matrix. So when we want to write a formula which is valid in any system of coordinate, we have to lower index of this vector. And of course you know what to do. This means that we must apply metric tensor, and this will be EL. So this is correct formula, which is coordinate independent of this naive formula which people used in 19th century. Actually, I am cheating, because in 19th century they were calculating E and D in different units. Therefore, it was something like E0 and so on and so on. But I am using such physical units that all this, that both sides are measured in the same system of units. Okay. And the same here, yeah? That. No, excuse me, this is D, this is for D, because excuse me, and the same for BK, 1 over square root of determinant of G times GKL equal HL, yeah. So when we add those two identifications to these laws, then we obtain electrodynamics in the standard 19th century version. And what is the superiority of this notation with respect to Maxwell's or or Heaviside notation? Okay, the superiority of this notation is that it is valid in any curvilinear system of coordinates. Of course, if we use Cartesian coordinates, then this is a unit vector, this is one, therefore it reduces to the naive version. But this is, okay. And this is why we absolutely need a metric tensor, in not only in three but also in four dimensions, because this is three-dimensional metric on t equal constant, right? Whereas here we need four-dimensional metric tensor. Okay, so now I will discuss this four-dimensional metric, which was invented practically by Hermann Minkowski. Because previously, when Einstein was discussing then he was already aware of the fact that space and time mix. But still, the clear knowledge of the metric structure of space-time was absent in his papers. His paper about special relativity was written in 1905, whereas Hermann Minkowski invented this structure in 3 years later, and this was an enormous simplification, an enormous simplification. So Minkowski told us the following thing, that okay, if we have space, then we have this metric tensor GKL for 3 centuries, starting from Newton. People were always using Cartesian coordinates and did not pay so much attention to the metric. They were just using Cartesian coordinates. The metric was a unit, but of course, for many purposes, we must use curvilinear coordinates. For example, Newton, when he was able to capture the trajectories of planets, you probably know this because this belongs just to the standard undergraduate course in classical mechanics, find the form of those trajectories, which are ellipses, we use spherical coordinates, because otherwise we are unable to solve Newton equations. In spherical coordinates, of course, the metric tensor is no longer unit matrix. But okay, so people were able to recalculate their calculations to curvilinear coordinates. Clever people. But they always considered Cartesian coordinates as something better. Cartesian coordinates are the true coordinates, and spherical coordinates is just a technical tool to solve some complicated equations. Whereas now we say, no, any coordinate system is equally good. For example, Cartesian. And now Hermann Minkowski realized that all those complicated formulae which were written by Einstein mean only that in fact there is a metric structure, there is a four-dimensional metric structure, which means that we are able to calculate the four-dimensional distance. And his proposal was that when here is time axis, here is x axis, so this g mu nu is this space metric which we already know for 300 years, and he would put 1 here. In fact, they always had a problem because at the beginning they always calculated space distances in meters, whereas time distances in seconds. So you cannot add meters to seconds. Therefore, they were putting C. But from the very beginning, during this lecture, I was trying to to show you that it really pays to calculate, to measure time in the same units as a distance, using speed of light as a proportionality coefficients. Because if we were in Newtonian physics, then there is nothing such as a universal speed of light. Yeah, because in Newtonian physics, if our planet is running 30 kilometers per second in this direction, therefore, the speed of light coming from this star is 30 kilometers per second higher than the speed of light coming from this star. And 60 kilometers per second as far as the light coming from that star is concerned. Therefore, there is no universal speed of light. But Michelson proved that no, whenever we measure